Everybody say home.
Home.
I saw Carl do that. I just wanted to try it. Thank you, Carl. Since 1993, I've been buying and collecting homeless signs from the homeless. It's really perfect that I followed Brandon. Amazing connection to what he's doing. Now, I want to set your expectations. I am not an expert on the homeless, on homelessness. I am simply a guy trying to make it through this crazy trip that we're all on and trying to figure it out. My invitation to you today is perhaps for you to rethink home and the homeless. This all began because of my discomfort and my awkwardness when I'd pull up to an intersection and I'd see somebody with a sign who was asking for money. I made up stories about them. I was awkward. I didn't want to make eye contact. There was a part of me that judged them and then immediately judged myself. I felt guilty. Should I give them money? What are they going to do with the money? Is it even okay for me to be asking that question? The process pretty much happened the same way all the time. I'd roll down my window, I'd say, hey, can I buy your sign? They'd usually say, sure. Then we'd negotiate a price, and I'd notice a shift. They had something I wanted, and the dynamic between us changed. Now, as you might imagine, this led to lots of interesting stories in the conversations that I had with the homeless. Some were very short, some were longer. There was a woman in Austin who only had one leg. She had lost it from about here. And she told me in great detail about the boating accident that happened when she was 20, where she lost her leg, how she was really close to death. And she was hilarious. I didn't expect that when I pulled up to the intersection. There was another guy. He got so interested in having a conversation with me because I told him that I was going to take these signs and I wanted to do something art, you know, to make some sort of art project with them. He didn't want to stop talking, and when the cars behind me started honking, he flipped them off and started yelling at them. He was into it. There was a really thin woman one time who was crying as she gave me her sign and told me that her deceased husband had made it. She flipped it over and showed me his name. The stories were plentiful. Not all of them were heartbreaking. Some of the signs were funny. This came from a friend of mine in San Francisco. And what I noticed was that my friends were eager to get in on helping with this project. And the more I talked about it with people, the more I realized they made up stories about the homeless too. They had stories before they even knew who these people were. And so everybody was struggling, or so it seemed, and my friends continued to be willing to help out, which I love because I've gotten a lot of interesting signs from all over the place. The price has ranged from $4 to $25. As I said, I let them set the price. Now, I've had two people turn me down at $25 for their sign. I had to set some sort of a limit because I did not want to be the first guy on the street who was there because he had bought too many homeless signs. So, as I continued to collect these signs, I noticed that I got more comfortable. I'd shake hands. I just started to have a real connection to the people on the street. No fear anymore about talking to them. And what the big shift I noticed was that it was no longer me and them. It was just us. It was just us. And that's one of the shifts I'm really grateful for. Because what is home? Really? Is it where I sleep? Is it where I'm from? Is it a house or an apartment? Is it where I feel safe? I've never been homeless. I grew up the oldest of eight in South Louisiana to a large and noisy family where we were constantly fighting for attention. It was also a scary place for me. My dad was old school. He had absolutely no idea of emotional awareness. He had a large family, he had very little money, and he was struggling to make ends meet. So he bottled up his anger, and when that anger got to be too much, he would unleash it, and it was usually on me, my siblings, my mom. There were visible bruises, broken doors, and worse. I came to realize that for me, home was not safe. But I made up a story about my childhood. And it was only a few months ago that I made this really crazy connection. In 1993, I started to buy and collect homeless signs. In 1993, I wrote a long letter to my dad confronting him about my childhood. I told him I wasn't going to be afraid anymore. I told him that I really wanted a different kind of relationship with him, that I wanted to know about his hopes and his dreams. And 3 months later, he wrote me a 5-page letter, which is now the most prized possession I own. And he came clean. He talked about the regrets about the way he raised us. And it really started to change our relationship, which I'm incredibly grateful for. What I started to believe at that point, and as I make this connection, is that maybe there was a little piece of me that was homeless, or a little piece that at least was averting my own eyes, not wanting to own parts of me, the neglected parts, the parts that yearned for safety. So meanwhile, I continued buying signs. I had a nice career in the advertising design world. It was wonderful. I sold my business in 2006, and in 2008 made the decision to go back to grad school, where I got an MFA in arts and technology. And that was really where the idea to make an art project around the sign started to take shape. I explored lots of directions, lots of critiques, lots of feedback. And in 2009, I had my first ever solo art show. It felt like I was coming home. I realized that art for me was one of the places that I felt at home. Now, at this show, I had all kinds of different stuff, but it all involved my homeless signs. Signs glued to mirrors, signs hanging from the ceiling. There were some glued to the floor that people would step on and then freak out about. I did some digital compilations that involved taking pieces from lots of the different signs and putting them together. I hired a homeless man for the opening to come and stand amidst the guests holding a homeless sign. He got to drink some wine, had some conversations with a lot of my friends who are not used to talking to homeless people. For me, this show was a big step, just personally. Afterwards, I continued to do more research. One of my classmates who liked to take photographs of where the homeless sleep invited me to join her. And we went into some really scary places and took photographs. It further deepened my awareness of who these people were and where they called home. The following semester, I took a class on interventionist art, art that in some way disrupts society, daily life. And being enamored with the homeless signs, I decided I was going to create a thing called We Are All Homeless. So 30 or 40 of us got together, a few blocks from here, right at Mockingbird and Central, and we stood in a line holding signs. Got to experience what it was like to be ignored by people in cars, averting their eyes. I thought it was pretty clear that we weren't homeless, but I got to experience that feeling, and my friends did too. It was a chance for us to raise some awareness. We were handing out cards to them, driving them to a blog that was titled, We Are All Homeless. And soon they started asking, when are we going to do another one? So we did another We Are All Homeless event. We had t-shirts printed. We gathered at the same location. The police came, of course, because they had to tell us where we could stand and what we could do. And we complied. And so we did a third one. The third one, we handed out dollar bills with the URL on them instead of the cards until the police made us stop because That was a disturbance. But what I realized is that there was this performance thing going on, and it was really something that was taking over. It was happening, and I just went with it. I thought I was going to be done with homeless signs after that first show, but that's not the case. At my MFA show, I did my first big installation where I covered a gallery wall with homeless signs. Now I'm part of a collective with some other UTD grads, and we are doing a series of shows. The first time I did a hanging sign installation, one of the performers, who's a dancer, interacted with the signs. In another one, we did an empty house where I got a room to cover the floor with signs and combined it with a video project that I'd also done. So this is continuing. I did a recent hanging installation that also is getting bigger, and I was forcing people to walk through the signs on their way to the door. The signs are a part of me now, and I can't let go of it. Every time I think I'm done, I want to move on to something else, it just pulls me back in. I'm now thinking about applying for a grant so that I can travel across the country buying signs and do some huge installation somewhere. I can't stop. Ideas keep coming. I've been shooting details from some of the signs, creating abstract pieces. I don't know if I'll ever show these, but it's just part of the process for me. I've started another series of photographs called Can You See Me Now? Because society seems to be okay with looking at young, attractive people. I figured I'll put them in the place of the homeless and see what the shift is like. So again, I don't know where this is going for me, but it keeps going. I don't have the answer to what is home. I'm still struggling. I still struggle when I pull up to the corner. I now see these signs as signposts of my own internal and external struggle with what is home. What does it mean to be homeless, physically, emotionally, spiritually? And I don't have the answer. My friends make fun of me because I love the movie The Wiz. But I believe that Glinda the Good Witch said it best. Darling, when you know yourself, you're always home. Thank you.